नमस्ते वेलकम टू डी टी यू ई शिक्षण प्रोग्राम आई डॉक्टर दाक्षायणी आर पाटिल असोसिएट प्रोफेसर एट बी एम एस कॉलेज ऑफ आर्किटेक्चर बैंगलोर वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू वंस अगेन टू दिस ई लेक्चर सेशन ऑन द कोर्स टाइटल्ड बिल्डिंग सर्विसेज 3 18 ARC 63 फॉर द बी आर 6th सेमेस्टर स्टूडेंट्स अंडर बी टी यू. So we have started off this particular course under the modules of 1 and 2 dealing with mechanical ventilation and air conditioning. Currently we are doing the module 2 which has 3 sections, air conditioning systems. Under that this particular lecture will deal with basics of duct sizing and routing. So the other aspects that I have colored gray are completed in the previous 8 lecture sessions under module 2. Overview of the references in place as stipulated in the syllabus. So module 2 lecture number 9 will be addressing under air conditioning systems. ADS, that is air distribution systems, and duct design. Okay, so lectures 9 and 10 will address the duct design aspect of the AC systems. So so far what we have done in the sessions is understood the various air conditioning types, unitary and central. And now we have gone, we have come to the next step of designing the understanding the air distribution system and designing the ducts in a HVAC layout. So this session today will be giving an overview of the air distribution systems called as ADS. We will look at the function, various components, types of ADS, salient aspects of air distribution system, a glance at the air outlets or the terminal grills. Alright, so this is what we will cover. In the upcoming lecture, we will do the actual duct design. Now, what is an air distribution system? It is that framework or the network component that is involved in a HVAC layout. So basically the entire HVAC setup has an equipment which does the process of conditioning the air. That is basically the refrigeration cycle which is happening there. Then there is a terminal unit. Terminal unit is the point of final output of the conditioned air into the space. So between the two, in a central air conditioning system, we are going to encounter a distance between the terminating unit and the processor unit. So how do you communicate between the two? So that is when the whole concept of air distribution system comes into place. Now, the objective of ADS is to achieve proper levels of temperature, humidity, cleanliness, and air motion in the occupied zone of the conditioned area. So basically, what we would want to achieve is the expected levels of human comfort in terms of 4 aspects, that is temperature, ambient temperature, a good level of humidity, good clean air, cleanliness of the air, air motion, that is the velocity of air, the air draft that is essentially needed in a well ventilated indoor comfortable space. So we have to achieve this, or enabling the reaching of this kind of a conditioned air to the occupied zone of the conditioned area. Now, occupied zone is normally the 1.5 to 2 meters from floor level. That is the space or volume that is used by people who are in that space. So our aim is to see that the ADS makes available the required quality of air, quantity of air to reach this particular occupied zone. Now for unitary AC systems like window, package, some of the package units, we do not need air distribution system. They are unit components which sufficing for a particular room, not a very large scale, and there is no terminal unit or generating unit. It is all packaged, factory assembled as a single unit, and it just assembled in the room. So ADS comes into picture when we have when we are separating the components of the AC equipment into two, or we are encountering a large scale building area where we are providing central air conditioning system. So we can see some of the images where you will be actually seeing the ducts that are moving just below the ceiling from one point to another, network of ducts, and finally the resistors or the diffusers at the end of the ducts, various turning angles which are called as duct elbows, different cross sections of ducts meeting each other. So it's a complex field of design. So very logically we have to proceed with a good air distribution system. Otherwise the whole effort taken in conditioning the air by the AC apparatus is not going to reach its intended destination, that is for the human comfort. And also there are so many complexities involved here. When you are designing a duct, you might have to keep in mind the financial constraints, the energy component. The duct design is going to directly impact the energy consumption and relatively to the incurred expenses. So deciding the right size of duct, the right material of duct, the right design of duct, the right layout of duct, all these complexities are a part of the air distribution system. And we will be seeing components, salient aspects of the same across the two lectures ahead, including this one. Mostly the service provider, the engineer, contractor will propose a layout after the architect issues the detailed architectural plan to him. So the architectural plan should be overlaid with the structural grid also, the columns, the beams. It is very essential because the ducts are going to be housed or nested with whatever space is available. So it's a very integrated cohesive process that has to be followed. And I would recommend reading the book by Professor P.N. Ananthanarayan, 4th edition, Basic Refrigeration and Air Conditioning, and also the book by Edward Peter, which is about air conditioning, principles and systems and energy approach. There are many various other good books also. So it is good to understand the various perspectives and also the market study to understand, correlate with what is available in correlation to the principles of design. So the function of ADS primarily is to convey air between two points. That is our intent. Say from between the AHU room, AHU unit, to the room to be conditioned. Now in the AHU, there is the evaporator which is going to take in the hot air, and it is going to be sent back to the room as supply clean air. So we need to have the connection between the two. Also, it carries the room air back to the AC apparatus for conditioning, for cleaning, for cooling, for dehumidifying. So that is the point of interaction where ADS comes into picture. And it has to be very clearly understood that it's an important aspect in HVAC design and planning. There should be no error or miscalculations, negligence, or missing out any details in the architectural plan that might impact a whole lot of scheme of events in the HVAC ADS system. So to the right you see a probable duct which is rectangular in size. The corners are called the duct elbows, and it has to be hung from the ceiling. There's a weight component, there are lights happening, there are these kind of registers happening. This is a exposed ducting. We have concealed ducting in the false ceiling as well. So these design decisions have to be a part of the HVAC layout. Architect has to be conversant to be able to make such decisions when meetings happen with the contractors, service providers, client, or so engineers. Now, a flowchart of the HVAC system requirements. This is the requirement. So, what do we have? Firstly, we have the primary equipment. Then we have the spatial requirement. Then comes the air distribution. Then the piping. Now, under primary equipment, this flowchart is a quick overview or a glance at the horizontal hierarchy of the HVAC system requirements. So briefly, we are pointing out what is the flowchart. Now, primary equipment comprises of heating equipment, cooling equipment, because AC has to cater to heating and cooling. Air delivery equipment. Then space requirements in terms of the equipment rooms, like can you give me an example? Yes, probably the plant room or the air handling unit, AHU room, electrical room, cable room. Then HVAC facilities, fan rooms, vertical shafts for routing the pipes and the ducts, equipment access for maintenance, for regular updating of the calibrations, cleaning and stuff like that. Then we have air distribution system. See, it's one of the important parts of the HVAC system, which will encompass terminal units and the ductwork, ducting. Very crucial, because it is going to take up a lot of your horizontal space in the building. Then piping for the system piping, delivery piping, etc. So air distribution, a component, is one of the critical aspects of HVAC system requirement. So every component is equally crucial, and each has its role to play, and each has to be critically designed, calculated, and in place by the architect and his counterparts. Now, this is a quick angular view of how complex a duct system is. These are available, and it's get an overview of what all components are there. Some of them are very technical words: boot, collar, ceiling head. And you can just run your eye across the view. End cap, return air drop, fresh air intake, joist panning. This is a very interesting thing, because the main duct is a bigger cross section. You need not have a bigger duct all through the building, right? When it reaches a room of 4x5 or 6x8, you don't have to have such a big. You will go in for a smaller duct. So then we need a duct reducer. Then they all end with a certain terminal point, end boots, register head. There is a connector when you have longer ducts in place. Plenum, the part where smaller control equipments are housed, it is under the false ceiling. So this is how an engineer will provide you with the precise duct layout to be executed on the site by the contractor or the service provider. So there are two types of possibilities in ADS. One is the open piping, or which is simply called as duct system. This is a system that is open to atmosphere at some point along its network. For example, a condenser cooling tower, a water system, which is a open piping. Closed system, on the other hand, water is continuously recirculated and there is no gap in the piping. Okay, a hydronic system is a all water system and is a closed one for that matter. So water is continuously recirculated and no gap in the piping. Two types of ADS possible. A technical representation of the closed piping and the open piping. So to the left we have closed piping system, where the total pressure consists of frictional losses. We are going to see this detail ahead when we do the duct design. These are going to impact the efficiency of the duct system. We should avoid the losses that are caused by friction loss, dynamic loss, or equipment loss. So that is our intent or objective when we are designing a good duct system. So it's a closed loop here, right? So you have the height of water in the pipe, the pressure due to the column of water in vertical pipe A cancels out the pressure due to the column of water in vertical pipe B. So it nulls. So not much of work done here, but when you have an open piping system, apart from the three possible losses, we also have to suffice for the static loss or static lift. So that is seen here. So here we have pressure due to the water in these two pipes which nullify. Then you have the static lift. The pump must lift the water through this height, which is called as the static lift. So more work is being done here. And the next one, pressure due to the water in these two pipes cancel out as well. So because they are equal on in either directions. So that is a brief on the closed piping and open piping system. Zoning. I think we have frequently come across this term when we speak about central AC or unitary AC or the whole concept of HVAC zoning, thermal zoning. It is a quantity of air to be distributed to various rooms or zones to be in proportion to the load of that zone. So we will divide a building into zones. We will group all the places or rooms that have similar demand, cooling load or heating load demand, and we will consider them pool up as a zone, zone 1, zone 2, zone 3, and each zone will have its own parametric decisions done with respect to the temperature, pressure, humidity, and it will be controlled. Each zone will have a control on its own. So that way we are making things simpler and also looking at good comfort conditions. If zone D does not require X amount of cooling load, but the entire building is designed for X, it is quite a waste of energy forcefully cooling it extra. So you will just calibrate it to the Z level that it is expecting. That is the intent of zoning. Zoning is a good design ideology under various headings. The temperature difference between room air and supply air should be ideally around 8.5 degrees Celsius. A suggested temperature difference between room air and supply air advised to be around 8.5 degrees Celsius, that is 15 degrees Fahrenheit. Now, supply air from the outlet, supply air is the clean cooled air which is coming out of the outlet, should be directed such that so as not to create an unpleasant draft at the occupied level. Now, we design these outlets very specifically in a given room along the false ceiling, and we illogically place them in such a manner that it is hitting only one corner of the room. So whoever is sitting there is going to get a hush of a draft falling on him or her, which is quite unpleasant. Rather, we design it in such a way that there is a pleasant draft by controlling the position or location of the terminal unit as well as the velocity or thrust of the air. So these things are important and has to be kept in mind when we do the inverted ceiling or the false ceiling plan and locating the registers at advisable or at appropriate distances and locations in the room. Our aim should also be to reduce the noise levels. And how do we modulate the noise levels? It is by controlling the velocity. Imagine a metal tube and we start blowing in the air with a good pressure. It is going to create certain turbulence or noise, right? So as you increase velocity, the turbulence and the noise levels increase. So ADS should aim at controlling these kind of noise when the distribution is in progress. So in one of the sources, we happen to see that in studios or operating theaters, etc., they have mentioned what should be the supply velocity to modulate and moderate the noise levels based on the velocity of the supply air. So factories, gymnasium, already the noisy areas and require more smoother or more draft of air to clear the impurities in the air, so we go in for more velocities. And also the air change per hour also might have to be calibrated appropriately. We can refer ASHRAE standards, the various standards that are released on a time to time basis, revised basis. Recently, post or during this COVID era, ASHRAE has revised the norms for indoor comfort designs. So kindly go through that on their website or on various publications. One more important principle in ADS would be the throw. Now, to the right side, you will see this is the terminal unit. It is a wall-mounted terminal unit. It could be a ceiling-mounted, it could be floor-mounted, whatever it is. The supply air that is coming out should, the distance to which it is thrown, that's why it is called as throw. Throw is the distance from the register that the air will travel at a corresponding velocity, at whatever velocity it is calibrated for. So it will travel to that much distance. 3/4 of the distance from the outlet to the opposite wall is the advisable or efficient design. So this were the throw, at least if the room was X, 3/4 the X, the supply air should be reaching, and that is what we have to aim for. Or if it were a big hall, and you have outlets on either ends of the hall, then from each outlet, at least up to the center line of the hall, the throw should be there. I hope I made it clearer. Or up to the center line of a hall where supply ducts and outlets are on either side of the wall. So if that is the hall, this is the center line, registers on both ends, the throw should at least reach the center line of the hall. Another word, spread. So same image, spread. Spread is the maximum width the airstream will travel at a corresponding velocity. So spread is the maximum width the airstream will travel at a corresponding velocity. One factor determining the amount of spread from a register is the angle of the vanes in the register. Now, vanes are those, imagine a ventilator which has the louvered ventilators, or you are passing through a metro station ticketing counter. They will let you pass through each aisle or each ticket counter where you drop your coin or token. So that center ones could be called as the vane. So it is directing the person towards from the station to the outside, right? So similarly, the amount of spread from a register is the angle the vanes of the register are turned. So louvers, if it is perpendicular, rotated at 30 degree or 60 degree, right? So that is the spread. So did you get now two main aspects of designing your ADS with respect to the outlets? You have to remember to keep the throw, that is this one, and the spread as maximum as possible should be the reach. Otherwise, if it were to reach here, and what happens to this area? So all the people, should they come here and occupy to enjoy the air conditioning? Clear? Moving on. Now there is there are two types of air that we will call primary air, secondary air. Primary air is a supply air emerging out of the outlet. Okay, primary air, that is a clean, cooled air, supply air, which is coming out of the outlet into the room that has to be conditioned. Secondary air, it is the room air that is picked up and carried along with the primary air. So it is not happening that primary air and secondary air totally away from each other. They are going to mix up. There is no strict boundary between the two, right? There is nobody, primary air doesn't say, I have drawn this line, secondary do not come to me. It is all going to be mixed up, and that's the logic that has to be addressed here. So air volume increases when they mix, so velocity decreases. The two meet at some point, so that is going to they're going to merge, and the velocity is going to reduce. Hence, high velocity at outlet is permissible. So we can take the chance of giving a good velocity, a good appropriate velocity at the outlet to avoid slower moving of the air due to the reduction of the velocity. So remember, the primary air and the secondary air mixing, velocity reducing, so at the outlet a good high velocity is permissible, allowed. If the throw and spread have not been planned, issues such as, in case whatever the two terms we saw, we are not paying attention to that in our designs, then there will be certain issues definitely in this space that we have conditioned, such as large temperature variations in a room, stagnancy of air, or drafts caused by excessive air movement shall be experienced. So temperature variations, the good spec variation in the room, stagnant air pockets, heavy drafts or slow drafts caused by the excessive air movement shall be experienced. All these are not going to create ambient indoor comfort conditions. The whole objective of AC will be compromised. That's why ADS, air distribution system, is only second to the equipment performance, very critical. Now, that's why location of supply registers is a very logical decision that we have to take. Very crucial. Now, we have been talking about outlets, grills, etc. So, what are the possibilities? There will be side outlet grills, these kind of circular, then you call them a side outlet grill, ceiling slot diffusers, like that, linear grills, many varieties. This is a false ceiling and they are there. In between we have light, in between we might even have detectors for fire, smoke. So amazing complex services that is embedded in the false ceiling. So very tactically arranging them without compromising on the light, without compromising on the outlet grills or the various other detectors or sensors, isn't it? So it is a very thoughtful modulated process. Some example, I just took it from the Daikin source. You can just see some of them that they have listed. Circular, what do they do? Adjustable flush with hidden pattern control for horizontal draftless air distribution to vertical projection plan. Deep outer cone reduces the smudging. Inner cone is a plug. Flange outer cone and adjustable square diffuser for directional control. From horizontal to vertical pattern, adjustable square diffuser with a plate, extruded aluminium construction, so aluminium linear grills, double direction supply grills with front louvers, vertical behind louvers, horizontal, so various codes also given, and the drawing, this is the plan, this is the section. Views at places. So those were supply air outlets, air diffusers or return air diffusers. So that is taking in the used air. They also come cylindrical, swivel type, fixed bars, filters, exhaust, return air grills, various innovative products published and marketed by various manufacturers and service providers. A good knowledge on these would certainly help in decision making. Then some of the shapes and way the supply air outlets are there. Now vane was this particular how it can be modulated, you can turn them to the required air direction mode. Then you have small slotted ones, linear ones, focused ones. So these are slot type. Industrial usage 10 to 30 kgs, aluminum, mild steel probabilities, rectangular, square, circular, round. The cost per SF per square feet. The various possibilities available, and we can choose the one that will suit our room, our space, and the given budget and efficiency required, right? The interior design, the colors, the options. And they are also called by different names. Tile diffuser, this in the similar fashion of a tile. Louver, in the form of a ventilator louver, you can turn the angles of these. Air diffusers, industrial heavy duty. So that was about introduction to duct and understanding the concepts of spread and throw, essential or salient aspects of air distribution systems. Now ahead, in the next lecture, I am going to deal with duct design, expected characteristics of a duct design, duct elbows, and such aspects of the detailed duct design. So after that, we will proceed ahead. So see you during the lecture number 10. Until then, see you. Take care. Thank you. We will sign off now.